My name is John Campion and I'm the West Mersey Police and Crime Commissioner, and I'm joined by Abby today, who I'll let her introduce herself.
I'm Abby Brooks and I'm the Resilience Building Programme Coordinator at Road Peace.
So Abby, really grateful for you talking to me today and really grateful for you being part of the work that Road Peace does, and really pertinent to talk to you during the National Roads Victims Month. Tell me a little bit about what brought you into contact with Road Peace and why you're so passionate around ensuring that families get the right support who've been involved with a terrible incident on the road in our three counties.
So in November 22, my little sister Molly, who was 19 at the time, she was killed in a road traffic collision. She was a passenger in her own car that was being driven by somebody who was under the influence. He had no license, no insurance. He was speeding. Molly had gone out on a Sunday with friends and this guy who was an associate of theirs. We hadn't thought anything of it. We'd all gone to bed that evening. She was still out and about. You know, she was 19. We wouldn't have expected any different. My mum seemed to have a bit of a feeling that something wasn't quite right, and she was actually waiting up on the sofa for her. My husband was working a night shift and I had gone to bed with my son, who was about 3.5 at the time. And around 3 o'clock I woke up and my husband was stood at the end of the bed and he said, "Molly's been in a crash." I knew that wasn't great. He said she was going to the Queen Elizabeth Hospital. And initially I thought, she's one of the only drivers in their sort of friendship group. I presume that she was driving. There was queries that she'd gone through the windscreen. I wondered how that had happened if she was driving. And that was kind of the start of, our awful experience. Molly was pronounced brain dead about 24 hours later, and the life support was removed. She passed away within about an hour of that being removed. And we left the hospital with just a box full of memories. For around 10 days, we kind of presumed that Molly was the driver. It was her car. She'd been out and about. We knew she was one of the only drivers in that group. We live in quite a small town, so we'd then kind of heard that perhaps she wasn't the driver and perhaps, you know, somebody else was the cause of the crash. And that was the start of it all, really.
So quite an extraordinary thing to wake up in the middle of the night to your husband to, and that journey then of finding those bits and pieces around what had happened, and ultimately somebody being held accountable through the court process. I've never experienced the incredible trauma and emotional challenges that you and your family will have suffered. How then did that translate into a connection with Road Peace? How was that? Was it just somebody mentioned it to you, or how did you end up, or was it something you were actively seeking out?
So it was first kind of mentioned to us within the first couple of days. We were handed a leaflet on Road Peace, and at that point you're so immersed in what's happening. I'd kind of popped it to one side, wasn't too bothered. And then a member of staff, who's now one of my colleagues, Kate, she got in touch with me about 10 days later, 2 weeks maybe, and, you know, offered that support. And at that point, I wasn't ready to kind of accept any support, accept any help. I didn't really know, you know, who Road Peace were or what they did, the support they could offer me. And Kate was brilliant at, she was quite persistent, and she said, "Oh, okay, well, we'll try again in a month and we'll try again next month." And we kept going and kept going. And I still wasn't ready. And, you know, everyone's timelines are different. Everyone's cases are different. I wasn't ready for a few months. And then I thought, I really need to keep busy. So we organised a fun day in Molly's memory. And I kind of thought, you know, it'd be really great to be able to fundraise for a purpose. You know, we'd had some help from another charity financially for Molly's funeral, and I thought it'd be great to give something back to them. And then I started looking into Road Peace and the work that they did and who they were supporting, and that's when that kind of happened, really. I was taken back by what they were doing for other people, and that was it. I thought, well, it'd be great to fundraise for them as well. At that point, I got in touch with Kate, and I said, you know, actually, it'd be really great to get some support from you guys, and I'd also like to give something back. Lucy then got in touch with me, and we became very close, having that similar sort of circumstances, having lost a sibling. We did some fundraising. I joined the siblings group, which was the best thing I ever did during that whole journey, was joining a siblings group and having somebody else recognise what I was going through as a sibling. You know, we quite often hear about parents losing their children or children losing their parents, but sibling loss is so unique. And I think it's really hard to find that kind of placement as to where do I fit in all of this. You know, you've got your own family, but you're also trying to look after your parents, and you're mourning the loss of a sibling, and that person you thought was going to kind of go through your life with you is now not there. So having that was I can't quite put into words how much that meant to me, having that group there.
Because we as in the state also don't always help, because we describe next of kin, don't we? Whereas
exactly.
I'd imagine your parents were described as the next of kin, but your sister. Mm.
Exactly. And I think it's that, you know, my parents were next of kin, but they couldn't quite, get to grips with having all of that pressure of, you know, these awful things were happening to Molly. You know, they had an investigation, a post-mortem, and the thought of that's horrendous. So as, you know, the older sister and the child that was left, I felt it was my duty to kind of have that communication with the police and take that off their plate. But by doing that, that then put more pressure on me. Yeah.
And your journey with Road Peace and your building of not only support but friendship, by the sound of it, isn't an intensive 6-week course. It's a longer journey than that, and that's quite at the core of what Road Peace can offer in
Absolutely.
Terms of support and some of the work that you're now involved in as a professional as well. Because you touch on the element of being ready, and people are all very different. And one of the things that really strikes me about Road Peace as well, not just a case of take it or leave it, it's in terms of it's tailored around the individual, but also when they're ready.
Yeah, and I think that's really important. You know, we don't have a timeline on, well, if you don't take our support here, then it's gone. You know, if you're not ready yet, then we're still going to be here waiting for when you are. You know, it doesn't matter if you're 5 days, you know, post bereavement, or, you know, 5 years, we're still here and we're waiting. And I think that's really important. For me, I think I wasn't obviously ready within those first kind of couple of weeks. Some people are, and they need that support from the get-go. I wasn't there. You know, it was a few months before I said, actually, yeah, I could do with some help, and, you know, what is that? And I think that's really important. We don't want to push people to say, well, it's here, take it or leave it. You know, we're here and we'll adapt to you.
I like the when we look at individuals as individuals and how unique we all are. I think another powerful part that I know from the Road Peace work is that processes like coronial processes or court processes or just investigations without even necessarily a court process, they're complex, they're full of jargon, they're full of people
Absolutely.
Who know how it works and you've never been involved in this in your life. And I also know that Road Peace do an element of that support through as well,
Absolutely.
Almost like jargon busting, I think, all the way through to, well, this is what you can expect.
Yeah, and I think, you know, when it comes to police, quite often, you know, this is the day in, day out. They sometimes don't quite remember that this is a family that likely haven't had any involvement with the police before. So having, you know, Road Peace as a support and being able to say, you know, I think quite often I went to Lucy and I said, what on earth does this mean? You know, I don't understand this. And, you know, please, can we dissect? And, you know, what are my rights surrounding this? And what can I ask? What am I entitled to know? And I think that's really important, because quite often we can presume families either want to know everything or nothing at all. And actually, you know, it's down to the families, like, it's their decision. You know, there might be bits that they want to know, bits that they don't want to know, and that's absolutely fine. And at Road Peace, we can help dissect that, and, you know, we can tell them what they're entitled to.
In terms of finding out about Road Peace, I know you mentioned that people get referred, and I know police will refer and all that, but if somebody is interested in Ropies and their work, how would they go about accessing?
So we have our referral forms online. You can self-refer, or like you said, the police can refer in. They can ring our helpline, and then we can signpost to different groups and different support that we can offer. We have our social media pages as well, so a lot of what we do goes on there. So we are everywhere, really.
We're popping Ropies into any search engine, yeah, will bring out a whole myriad of resources.
That's
and
right.
Indeed, those links into potentially those local groups as well,
which I think are absolutely paramount. You know, the local groups, finding people in your area that you can go to, and quite often friendships form through that, and having somebody that's been through something similar that understands what you're talking about in your area, I think is really important.
Because the terrible things that are the consequences of harm on our roads are everywhere, aren't they?
Absolutely.
They affect families across all our communities, unfortunately. So whilst it can feel sometimes very lonely, there will be others in your community who have suffered this terrible fate, because as commissioner I want to see less harm caused on the road and work really hard to make sure that we get ahead of the terrible cycle of harm being caused, and some people's terrible behaviours, some of the engineering that's not quite right, the skills aren't at the right levels, and I know that we can make progress, and we will make progress, but giving that support to victims in the meantime and their families, really really important. If magic wand territory, and we're talking about support, as it were, where do you think the area that we need to continue to develop the support offer might be as we go forward?
I think I'm really passionate about, obviously, sibling loss. I think we are starting, especially at Ropies, we have a group now, you know, a national siblings group. We're starting to kind of break through there a little bit, but there is still so much that we could give. You know, we could support siblings so much more than we already are, and I think just really highlighting that, I think that's so important. I also, like, I'm quite big on, we had a brilliant family liaison officer that you know, really supported us the whole way through. I think, you know, being able to highlight that as well, and the importance of being transparent with families where possible. I think that's also really, really important.
The role of the family liaison officer within the police is an incredible one, and one I don't think I would ever be able to have the fortitude to do. But when I talk to the families of those who have been lost on our roads, often that interaction with their flu, as they call them, is often really, really powerful, and I know that Ropies also do some inputs, don't they, with training?
Yeah, so I mean, I think we give more of a personal kind of understanding. You know, we'll talk to the family liaison officers and say, this is the feedback that we're getting, this is what families want. And I think especially for you know, Lucy and I as victims, it's really powerful for us to be able to sit here as staff and say, we were victims and this is what helped and this is what didn't help, and, you know, give that kind of personal aspect.
One thing I do know is that the people in the system, you know, want to do the right thing, and sometimes that knowledge is power, isn't it?
Absolutely.
I said earlier, I can't fully sympathise and empathise because I haven't had that experience, but you being able to share a terrible tragedy in a positive way to help potentially assist somebody out is an extraordinary thing. I said to you off camera, I'm a big fan of Ropies, you know, happily say it on camera as well, and as commissioner, it's incredibly powerful to be able to partner with an organisation who not only doing the work to support those that are families who are victim to the terrible harm on our roads, but also doing the campaigning part about how we make our roads safer.
Absolutely.
Because we should never disconnect the two, because lots of terrible choices are made on our roads that have the terrible consequences that you and your colleagues in Ropies have to support. And I know that through the campaigning arm as well as the support arm is how we make that difference. And I just want to thank you and your colleagues for the amazing work that you do out there. And as commissioner, it's a no-brainer for me to support some of the work that you do in the system, because the impact of it is extraordinary.
Yeah, I think, you know, we just want to, when people are flipping through those pages in the newspaper, they see those articles and they, you know, they see the photos of our loved ones, you know, they see the victims. I want people to realise that there's families behind those photos, and it's not as simple for us as just being able to kind of sweep past it. Something has to be done about it.
for me, a really important message to end the session on. Something has to be done about it. And as a commissioner, I'm absolutely clear that more can be done to support those families, absolutely. Build on the foundations we've got now, but the ultimate goal being eradicating death and harm caused on our road. And if anybody watching today wants to know more about Road Peace, if you put Road Peace into your search engine, there's lots online. There's links on my website and social media as well. And one message is clear, I think, that there is help out there
Absolutely.
For those who have suffered tragedy on our roads, and getting that help might be not right today, but it doesn't mean say it's not going to be right for you at some point, and it will be there ready when they are.